Welcome to this third and last session of this first conference day. My name is Cecilia Eriksson. I work at the National Library of Sweden, and I'm also a part of the interlibrary loan and resource sharing section, document delivery and resource sharing section, we're called, in IFLA. And I will be moderating this session, which has the theme Perspectives, the Needs of Scholars. So we will have the scholarly user perspective on these presentations. Our first presentation has the title From Interlending to Resource Sharing Between Scholars, an Analysis of Recent Development. And with statistical examples from Finland, this paper discusses how technological development is contributing to the fact that libraries are now only one of many options in academic resource sharing. And with that very short introduction, I will ask our presenters from Finland to please introduce themselves. So welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. I still have my papers. My name is Jarmo Saarti. I'm director at the University of Eastern Finland Library, and my colleague Kimmo Tuominen is from Helsinki University Library. Helsinki University is the largest university in Finland, and we are within the five biggest ones. So we come from big research-oriented universities both. And we have been working with Kimmo quite a long time and discussing these matters and also doing work with these issues, especially in Finland. And I think what we tried to accomplish here is that because the theme is resource sharing in a disruptive ecosystem, it sounds very intellectual, we are trying to show both what are the ecosystems at the present, and especially what are the disruptive, this is a difficult word for a Finnish person, disruptive elements that are affecting both how the resource sharing is happening at the present, and especially what is and what will be the library's role now and in the future, because there are quite big challenges at the present. As was mentioned earlier, the researchers can do quite a lot of things at the present. And we both, Kimmo and I, have also been conducting research, so we also know how the researchers actually act. I don't use that much libraries anymore. I use these disruptive ecosystems, and that's how it works. And so we'll be discussing about traditional IL practices in Finland, and I would like to emphasize that we are speaking about what's happening in Finland. We heard quite a lot of from different countries previously, and it seems that it's a bit different, but the same things are affecting at the global level everywhere at the present. Where you can use internet, you can use these things, and that's how it is. And Kimmo has been especially very keen on doing research on the social media things, and I'll start with the traditional things, and Kimmo will conclude with the more modern issues. So I have been working at university libraries now for 20 years. I'm getting to be a bit old in my career, and I have seen through the digital rise of the document delivery. And now I have seen this open access movement, and now especially what's happening with the social media things. And it has been actually quite interesting, but I think the most striking thing here is that this is and seems to become faster and faster process. It actually gets to be a bit difficult to know actually what the researchers are doing at the present. And I think that is the biggest challenge for us librarians, to keep up with the researchers, what they actually are doing, how they are doing these things, and how we can help, and where we can just say that you are doing it better than us, just do it. So what's happening with interlending library in Finland? And this is just from the beginning of this millennium. So from 2002, we are using here statistics from the Finnish National Research Library database. So this is all the academic libraries summed up. So we had a strong tradition of interlending in Finland, and it was based in the work that was done in 1980s. We had centralized specific libraries for every subject field in Finland, and the state of Finland subsidized very much the interlending. For example, the postal fees were non-existent because the post was still State Department then, and the interlending was actually very big resource for Finnish researchers till the beginning of 2000. And if we look at the statistics here, So the blue one is National Interlending Library. It still was quite big at the beginning of this. In 2002, it started to decrease quite rapidly, and actually at the present you can say that all these national interlending and international interlending is very minor thing. It still is important in some subject fields, but as a practice it has become very, very minor, and especially in those fields of research that grow and do very rapidly their progress, I personally think that it hasn't any role in it. This is a bit provocative, but we are trying to be provocative. Another thing that has also been mentioned here earlier is this e-document delivery. I was very much hoping for that we actually could achieve with something with it, but you can say that nothing happened. And if we look this next slide, I think this tells, and again, this is a picture of the Finnish situation. We had consortia building from the 1990s and still have quite strong consortias that has enabled almost all the university libraries to actually buy big packages of e-resources. And I think this is downloaded e-article, it still is growing a bit. What started to happen about 10 years ago was the e-book revolution. We had almost no e-books then, but when we took them into use, the growth of the e-book use is actually almost two times as big as the downloaded e-articles. Of course, you have to be a bit wary about these statistics, as we all know. And printed book loans have been decreasing. So the digital revolution was the first one that actually killed interlending in Finnish environment. And now to the second phase. So Kimmo, please. Oh, there's this one slide. Just to mention that we had this exchange of scientific literature thing going on in Finland. It was quite big in 1990s, but it also has started to decrease. And I think this is due to the fact that most of the Finnish universities open their research, so dissertations and master theses are now mostly open access, so actually it's not worth sending the printed copies. So this has also changed the environment. So the open access movement is also big, but we are not talking about that. It's for the next conference. Kimmo, please.
Yes, I'm going to talk about ResearchGate. This is our like example, our case, very popular social network. You know, we have, of course, researchers can use this kind of general social media for research-related purposes, like Facebook groups, for example, and distribute documents also there. But it seems that this in the Finnish context, this ResearchGate is the most popular. And I've read some research also that elsewhere also the ResearchGate uses is dominating the area. So the research gate is an example of academic social network, ASN, that they are like aiming, they are the Facebook of researchers, if you want to say it so. They are aiming their services for researchers. And they have, of course, many functions. You can make contacts through them. You can make your work visible in them. But one of the central uses is this resource, sharing your articles with others. And in this table, we have collected data from the Finnish universities, the institutional pages. We have gone through the institutional pages of Finnish universities in ResearchGate. And here we have some numbers. And it seems that ResearchGate is very widely used, and it contains numerous publications written by Finnish researchers. For example, for University of Helsinki, 57,000 articles. And what is impressive is this number of reads, this last column on the right, because there you have just reads for 1 week. So that shows how much it is really globally also used. And of course, it also shows that the biggest universities, as Jarmo mentioned, like our universities, they are very active also in here. We don't know how many of these publications are available as full texts. There might be just metadata for some publications, but at least the people who have high so-called ERC scores, this is the visibility metric of ResearchGate. At least those people seem to import their documents quite regularly into ResearchGate. And you can compare these numbers to the fact that our researchers, Finnish researchers, annually publish about 38,000 scholarly articles. And of course, also through this ResearchGate, if you don't have the full text in the ResearchGate, then you can order it directly from the researcher, from the author. And this is the ResearchGate institutional page of my university, University of Helsinki. And this, so ResearchGate collects the number of reads, the top reads by country and by institution on a weekly basis. So this is 1 week, I think week 31 on the summer, June. And when I discuss with researchers, some of them assume that all the papers in ResearchGate, they are like open access, they are available as open access. But this is not the case, because the ResearchGate requires, when you first go there, it requires authentication. So you have to reveal your identity or invent a fake one. And as we know, our activities, our contacts, our interests, they are the real currency of the internet age. So in this sense, academic social networks offer no free lunches to our researchers. Okay, one of the things I was thinking about concerning this ResearchGate is how permanently it really stores the full texts. Of course, there might be copyright problems with the papers, and it's operating in a gray area. In a way, it's not like SkyHub, which is the shadow library, in a way, illegal library. But can we be sure that all the papers we have there will be also available in the future? That was one of my question, and we don't know, of course, how the business model of of ResearchGate, how it evolves in the future, and we don't know if the service will cease to exist one day. So there is this kind of things we are unsure of, and of course, also the legal problems might hinder the use of ResearchGate in the future, and also endanger the permanent availability of documents. 17 big publishers have formed the coalition of responsible sharing in October 2017 to address the copyright infringing practices of the ResearchGate site, as they say. This coalition has forced ResearchGate to remove 1.4 million articles from the site. And the coalition still sees that the ResearchGate contains millions of copyrighted articles, and that the service, they claim that the service is not taking any responsibility for its illicit activities. So now we come to the concluding part of the presentation. As Jarmo said, we have seen the falling of ILL, falling of printed loans, and also rise of the usage of these e-books, e-journals. And Finnish researchers seem to be very active users of academic social networks, where they can like disseminate documents and also promote their expertise and so on. They might be aware of the copyright problems with ResearchGate, but it seems that they don't, at least they don't seem to care of them too much. The rise of these kind of academic social networks might also generate new kinds of problems because they might be strategic risks to universities. The business models and these black box algorithms of these networks might not align with the basic academic goals and values. I think Dr. Amato this morning was talking about problems with metrics in her keynote speech. The main risk with these academic social networks is that the private sector might get too great a role in the analytical assessment of the universities and the performance of our staff and students. So this is one of the reasons why research librarians should be more aware of the development and current nature of academic social networks. And also we should be able to give our academics relevant information on the potentials as well as possible problems of informal resource sharing in ASNs and also of course elsewhere. Lastly, I would say that even though ILL is not able to compete with academic social networks, in some cases it might still be the last resort of our users. And I think we should be able to offer our users a legal way to get the information they need. As academic integrity and responsible research becomes more and more important, we should not drive our scholars into a situation in which they have to break the law when accessing information. Like responsible scholars, we also need responsible academic libraries and librarians in the future.
Thank you very much for this interesting presentation. And I wonder if anyone has a question.
So I was astounded by the number, the way both circulation in general, but interlibrary loan just dropped. Does Finland have a I know, like in the U.S., we don't have a national library that buys ebooks and has that kind of strategy. Institutions are sort of on their own, and I don't think we've been as aggressive about moving with ebooks. I'm curious if you could tell us about what the ebook strategy is and whether you think that's contributing to this kind of high use of ebooks and low use of print and ILL.
Well, Kimmo can answer from his part, but for example, at Mao University, we combined two universities and our campuses are about 120 kilometers apart. So it was a strategic decision to buy as much e-books as possible. And it actually was a good decision because the younger students, they read e-books. It's not a problem for them, but it's just my universities.
Yeah, in our context, it's also that Open University is very important, that for the students of Open Universities, it's important to have like e-books. And the other thing that is quite peculiar to Finland is that we buy so many like textbooks for the students. I'm not sure about the Czech situation, but in Finnish situation, we buy them. And you know, there is never enough textbooks. So that's one of the reasons why we would like to have e-books. There is no national, the national consortium in our context, it mostly takes care of these big bundles of toll access journals like Elsevier and so on. Not so much e-books, so we are like on our own with e-books. What we've been doing in Helsinki recently is that we are like building an open access publisher of e-books called Helsinki University Press. So the first books will come out in January 2020. So that's my advertisement here. But you know, it's for the students also, when the ebook is really open, so it's much more easier for the students to access it, no DRMs and so on, as we have heard, and no need for interlibrary loans because it's open access.
My question is, you were talking about ResearchGate and the need for libraries to try and encourage academics to be responsible about the sharing, so they're not sharing things that are illegal, which, as you say, has happened on ResearchGate. What suggestions would you have for librarians? How would you get librarians to promote that, to promote using legal copies as opposed to just using what's easy? If that makes sense, sorry.
Yeah, so of course, one of the reasons why ResearchGate is so much used is the intuitive nature of the user interface, and it's very easy usability. I think there are at least in our university, there are like wrong kind of conceptions of ResearchGate. So that's where I've seen some problems because, for example, some scholars think that when you have your paper in ResearchGate, then it's open access. So this is one of the big discussions I've been having with my academics sometimes, to show that it is not open access. And in the future, in our funding model, also in the Finnish funding model, open access is rewarded, but publishing in ResearchGate is not rewarded. I think we should not be like policies of copyright. There are problems with copyright, but I think they should be solved, and of course libraries should be like follow the copyright. But well, yeah, but we are not the moral policies in this sense.
Okay, so it's time for our next presentation under this theme of users and scholars. And the next presentation has the title Challenges and Opportunities for Scientific Data Management and Sharing Services in Chinese Library Community. And this paper gives an overview of the role of Chinese libraries in managing and sharing research data. and how the work with this is structured. And with that short introduction, I would like you welcome you to introduce yourself.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. So I'm so glad to be here to visit all of you. So nowadays, the data, especially research data, has been the most important part of the library information. There are more chances that our library clients have the request to access the research data. So my presentation here is challenges and opportunities for research data management in China library community. And my name is Xu Huifeng, and I come from National Science Library of Chinese Academy of Sciences. Firstly, I will introduce a little about my library. So the Chinese Academy of Sciences has more than 100 research institutions, 3 universities, and more than 68,000 employers and over 52,000 graduate students. So the library system of the Chinese Academy of Sciences has one main library, 2 branch library, and more than 100 research institutions library located in more than 20 cities in China. And the picture is the main library, which is I worked in. So the focus of my presentation include the gap between research data management demand and the realities. Then the China's research data management practices, including the policy system, national platform, university data repository, and the journal data publishing. After that, I will overview the library's research data management service patterns and the SWOT analysis of the library service. And the last is the suggestions and the recommendations. So the gap between the demand and the reality. The demand includes there is growth spurt of the amount of research data in China. The total amount of research data effectively managed and preserved in China is approximately 80 PB. And the new data-intensive research paradigm and the learning paradigm are depending more and more on big data and the data mining. But the reality is the research data management practices still need to be improved. Like the policy, the national level, first national level research data policy was issued very recently at 2018. And we have several university data repositories compared with the China's 2,879 universities and colleges. There are a lot of work need to be done. As narrowed to the library services, the library did not play the leading role in research data management in China. So there are a lot of practices to fill up the gap. First is the policy. The State Council has released several data development policies, including the big data development policy and the government information resource sharing policy. But the research data management targeted policy was issued at last year, 2018. And actually, after each policy is released by the State Council, the administrations and the ministry will release the more detailed policy in specific industry and field, like the State Oceanic Administration, Ministry of Transport, Ministry of Agriculture, and so on. The most worth mentioned here is the research data management and open sharing policy issued by Chinese Academy of Sciences at this year. This is the first or maybe the only policy really is issued by the research institution in China so far. So sum up for the policies, because most of the policies are issued by the state council and the ministries, so it is pretty predictable that there will be more policies be released by funding institutions and the research institutions in the future. And the policies released in the future should ensure DMP function carried out with the research project and make more clear on assignment of responsibilities, operational processes, sharing, and access. So the other practices of research data management in China is the national platform. The Ministry of Science and Technology and the Ministry of Finance, they supported the establishment of national platforms in eight fields. It include basic science, agriculture, forest, and so on. And this year, the two ministries, they make optimization and adjustment of the eight platforms and formed the 20 National Science Data Center. And because the National Science Data Center just started, so they will coexist, the eight platforms and the science data center, they will coexist in a long time in the future. So I posted the website of the eight platforms in case that your library has a request to access this research data. The bad news here is that the policies did not mention the library at all, and the library did not play the policymaker role. And also, the library did not take part in the establishment of the national platform. But anyway, these platforms, they make big progress, but there are also some disadvantages. Like the platforms, they integrate all the data resources, support one-stop discovery, but some platforms, they did not they are not true data fusion and did not name all the data entities with URI. And the platforms adopted disciplinary specific metadata standards without adopted common standards like Dublin or DataCite scheme. The platforms support focused more on storage instead of service. We found that the amount of the data volume is at TB level, each platform, but the service volume is at GB level. So I thought the big progress these platforms make is the standards and the regulations. They formed three types of standards and regulations for the research data management in the future, especially from the 18 national research data standards. And so the other practices of research data management is university data repositories. Nowadays, we have four university data repositories, roughly. They have come from Peking University, Fudan University, Wuhan University, and the Shanghai International Studies University. And here we have the website of the repositories. They adopted the Dataverse and the DSpace as the infrastructure. But when compared to the almost 3,000 universities and the colleges, I have to say the university libraries has a big develop space. So the last practice I will introduce here is the journal data publishing. We have three journal support data independent publishing. The first is China science data, and the second is the journal global change data, third big earth data. They started separately at 2015, 2017, and 2018. And the first China science data supported multiple disciplinary data publishing. So still there are no good news because the library did not take part in the journal data publishing. And the good news is three or four of these data repositories, the libraries take part in to the establishment. So I overview the library's research data services by investigating 20 academic libraries services. Generally, there are five types. The first is research data establish a research data management platform. The second is integration all the data resources into library discovery system, like Primal system or Summon system. The third is providing consulting and training services. The fourth is data analysis and visualization. The fifth is open access data integration and navigation. But when compared to the other libraries, research data management services, I would like to say that the Chinese libraries still have to develop the service. So the SWOT analysis about the library research data management services, the external opportunities for the China library communities include the innovation of science and technology demand, the new research paradigm demand, and the second opportunity is the data growth spurt, and the country attached great importance on research publishing and management. And the reality is the data publishing and the management is underdeveloped. So the external challenge include the libraries has not adequately prepared to make the transformation for new research paradigm. There is no strong voice or agile strategy or plan from the library. And also the library playing the leader role in the research data management services has not been recognized at all, especially in the top administration level. But there are advantages for the library to conduct the research data management service, like the libraries has realized that the research data management service is a new era of growth and are actively acting all the possible practices. And also library has rich experience on informational infrastructure operation and maintenance, and rich experience on information organization and service. And the research data is just a kind of information, right? So, but the disadvantage of the library is that the library still has no problem solving strategy and implement plans. And also the libraries lack top talents because the top talents prefer more to get involved in the IT section instead of lower paying library professional, something like that. Even though there are a lot of gaps and there are some practices to fill up the gaps. We still have a lot need to do, to be done. So there are some recommendations and suggestions for the library community. The first is the library community and the library alliance have to strengthen dialogue with all the stakeholders, especially with the top administration, to make them aware of the library's professional in research data management service. And the second is the library community should make the instruction of research and the service priorities for as reference for all the libraries. Then some service priorities for the suggestions for the library, like the library should integrate all the data resources, especially make data localization and make the data service authorized. The third is the library should try their best to cooperate with the research institution or cooperate with the university to playing the leading role in the data repository establishment. And the last is the libraries should build a digital scholarship platform or a digital research ecosystem to support one-stop data discovery or cooperative online research between different countries, different research teams. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this presentation. I think research data is something that libraries will speak increasingly of. And does anyone have a question?
I was actually thinking we could do one question maybe if there was one, but we are getting close to needing to wrap up and summarize. It looks like maybe no questions, but I do think research data is something that our committee in resource sharing needs to think a lot about. So this was a really important presentation to get us thinking about how do libraries, you mentioned how your libraries weren't involved in the initial planning and how the impacts of that. And so that's something that we need to try to catch up and get ahead of so that we don't fall behind and then cannot provide the research data that our users need. So thank you very much for that presentation.